Good day, brothers and sisters. Welcome at another Bible study on the book of Revelation. Today we are studying Revelation 19, starting in verse 11 through to 20, verse 10. Before we begin the Bible study, let us first pray. Our Father in heaven, Almighty God, we humble ourselves before your holy throne. We know that you are our God and our Father, and that you rule over all creatures. We know that this entire world is subject to you, and nothing happens without your will. It gives us comfort, and also in this world in which we live, with all that is happening around us, we may have the certainty that your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, is gathering his church from the beginning of the world to its end. Give us then that we may be encouraged and comforted also by this Bible study, that we may be strengthened to persevere in faith, because we know that the end is certain, and your Son will come again to judge the living and the dead. Father, give us a good understanding and glorify your name, also when we may study your wonderful works as being recorded in this part of the book of Revelation. This we pray in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Brothers and sisters, in this part of Revelation, we are talking about Revelation 19, verse 11 to 20, verse 15. There we see three separate visions which belong together, which form a unity. And in these visions, we see how Christ and how God deal with the three enemies. First, we see how the beast and his armies are defeated in chapter 19, verse 17 to 21. Thereafter, we read about Satan, the dragon, how he is defeated in chapter 20, verse 1 to 10. And then finally, in 20, verse 11 to 15, we see how the last enemy, death and Hades, are being destroyed. Today in this Bible study, we will look at the first two visions. The third one will follow in a sermon coming Sunday. It is important to keep in mind that what is being described here in this part, in Revelation 19 and 20, it is not chronological. It fits in the structure of the book of Revelation. And the whole book of Revelation is not chronological, as we have seen before. First, in chapter 6, there, when Christ is opening the seal, the seals, the seven seals, then we see that in the first four seals, especially the fourth seal, death is being introduced as the great enemy. Then in chapter 12, the dragon is being presented as the second enemy. And in chapter 13, we see the beast and his prophet, the beast from the sea and the beast from the land. Now here in chapter 19 and 20, we see them in reverse order. They are all three being dealt with. And this reverse order, there's a style figure, which we call a chiasm. First, the beast and his prophet are being dealt with, and then the great dragon, and then in chapter 20, verse 11 to 15, finally, death, the last enemy, is being destroyed. Let us read the first part, the first vision. Verse 11 to 16. Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, Come and gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and of those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. And I saw the beast, the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. And the rest were killed with a sword which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse. And all the birds were filled with their flesh. John sees heaven opened here, in 4 verse 1. In 4 verse 1, there he saw heaven opened, there it was a door that was opened. Now heaven is wide open, and that indicates it's going to a climax. It's coming close to the end. And then he sees a white horse and his rider. And then again, the description of the white horse and his rider is full of symbolism. It repeats what we have seen earlier in the book of Revelation. The color white we have seen before a number of times. White, that indicates it is the color of heaven or the color of holiness, of righteousness. We see the white horse. In Revelation 6 we saw the white horse, the first seal being opened. There it was followed by three other horses. However, here there is only one horse. He is not being followed by other horses anymore. No, now he is victorious. We read about the name, faithful and true. We have seen that in chapter 3, verse 14, in the letter to Laodicea, where the Lord speaks about himself as the one who is faithful and true. We read about eyes, which are a flame of fire. That is what we saw in chapter 1, verse 14, and also 2, verse 18, the letter to Thyatira. We read about a sharp sword, which comes out of his mouth, and we saw that in 1, verse 16. We also see here many connections with other parts of the Bible. In righteousness, he judges and makes war. That is also what is being said about him in Isaiah 11, verse 3 to 5. His robe dipped in blood, that comes from Isaiah 63, verse 1 to 3. And treading the winepress also comes from Isaiah 63. An iron rod being mentioned here comes from Psalm 2. Here we see many lines from the entire Bible coming together in the book of Revelation. It's coming to a close, the Bible is coming to a close, and it is all being summarized here in the book of Revelation. We read four times even about the names of this rider on the white horse. Names in these verses, it is not about personal names, but about titles, about functions. Names which describe his function, his task. First, we saw that his name is faithful and true. He is the one who fulfills God's word, because God's word is faithful and true. And also, he had a name written that no one knew except himself. Just as his followers get a new name, as we have seen before, so also he himself receives a new name. But here, no one can understand that name yet. It will only be revealed when the end has come and all will have been fulfilled. Now nobody understands the full extent of God's work yet. Only Christ does, and therefore only he knows the name. And then the name, the Word of God. He is the Word of God. He is God's judgment. The Word of God, God's judgment, is both in a saving sense for the righteous, as well as a condemning sense for those who are evil. In Lord's Day 31 of the Heidelberg Catechism, we see the Word being described as a key of the kingdom. It opens and it closes. As judge, Jesus Christ speaks God's Word, God's judgment. And Lord's Day 31 then says, according to this testimony of the Gospel, God will judge both in this life and in the life to come. And in the end, we see that his name is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And that is being confirmed in the description that he has many crowns. He has royal authority over all the earth, over all the kingdoms. He does not have just a limited number of crowns, as we saw with the beast and the dragon, but he has many crowns. He has all authority in heaven and on earth. And the armies in heaven followed him. They are clothed in white, fine linen, clean clothes. And this is a description of the angels following him. And maybe also Christians are included who are already in heaven. White, again, white, fine linen shows the holiness and the righteousness of these armies. This is the army of righteousness. Those who follow Christ. And then we read that an angel invites the birds of heaven to come to the victory banquet of the great God. In chapter 19, verse 6 to 10, we read about the marriage supper of the Lamb. Here, as a contrast, we read about the supper of God's wrath. Those who are being defeated by the rider on the white horse, they are going to be the food. Birds are invited to gorge themselves on those who have been slain. The flesh of kings, captains, and mighty men, that is choice food for those birds. And also the flesh of all people, free and slave, it indicates an abundance. They will fill themselves with their flesh. It is remarkable that this invitation goes out already before the battle. The armies of the enemy are being presented in verse 19, that still has to come. And this is just like it was in Egypt. Israel already had to celebrate the Feast of Salvation, the Passover, before Pharaoh's host was killed. So there God already announced that Pharaoh would be killed, and that was certain. So also here, God's judgment is certain. The invitation goes out already before his judgment is fulfilled. There is no doubt. The outcome of the battle is certain. And that may be a comfort for God's people. Here we see that the enemies of God's people are being repaid with what they themselves did to the saints. As we read about in chapter 18, verse 6. In Psalm 79, there we read a description of how God's people is being defeated and their bodies are lying on the battlefield. In Psalm 79, there we read, "The dead bodies of your servants they have given as food for the birds of the heavens, the flesh of your saints to the beasts of the earth." And that were the enemies who attacked God's people. Now they will be repaid, and their bodies will lie on the battlefield as food for the birds of heaven. In verse 19, the enemy is being described, the beast and his prophets, as we saw them in Revelation 13. Here again, it is important to remember the description in Revelation 13. There, the beast was being described with the number 666, and there it was said, it is the number of man. It is not the number of God, it's the number of man. So here, the beast, we read about the power of man. It is only the number of man. And mankind, they are gathered together here to make war. But right away, the beast, the great leader, was captured with his prophet. We don't even read about the beginning of the battle. They came together to be captured. God gathers them together for their defeat. And these two, the beast and his prophets, were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. This lake of fire is the sign of God's eternal wrath. Our Lord Jesus Christ, as we can read in the Gospels, also spoke about the eternal fire, the fire that will not be quenched, where their suffering will never end. And then the rest, all those who followed the beast and his prophet, they were killed with a sword, which is the word of God. The word condemns and kills them. It is not with earthly weapons, earthly power. Earthly power is powerless before the word of God. The word of God, the sword of the Spirit, kills them all. And the birds gorged themselves on their flesh. They were filled. It is an abundance. Now we go to the second vision, where we see that Satan is bound for 1,000 years. Chapter 20, we read first verse 1 to 3. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years were finished. But after these things he must be released for a little while. And they saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. And they saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the work of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now, when 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. They went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and a false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night, forever and ever. The beast and his prophet are destroyed. Now God shows to John how also Satan will be dealt with. The serpent of old, he is being called here. And with that, we go back in history. The perspective shifts to the beginning. As I said before, these visions are not in chronological order. The beginning, and that is where it all started, with the rebellion of Satan. And this vision shows that throughout history, Christ reigns, even though Satan may be powerful. Satan had time in the beginning to roam on the earth, but then an angel came and locked him up in a bottomless pit for 1,000 years. Bottomless pit. The pit was often used for a prison in the time of Israel. We see several times that it is being described that someone is thrown into a pit. Here it is a bottomless pit. It's very deep. Satan cannot get out of it. It is impossible for him to get out of it. And it is confirmed when we read how it is be described that the angel bound him. He cast him in the bottomless pit. He shut him up with the key which he had. And he set a seal on him. There are four actions. So that indicates there is abundance of safety. There is no way that the dragon will get out again. He bound him for 1,000 years. 1,000 years, that indicates a very long time. The word thousands for the Jews often indicated something like eternity. A time period that they could not grasp with a human understanding. In Psalm 105, God speaks about 1,000 generations. This number 1,000 forms a contrast with the time of the beast, which you have seen before. It is time, times, and half a time. 3.5. Revelation 11 was 3.5 days. We must see these times as symbolic. The time for evil is limited. Time, times, and half a time. You can count it. The time for righteousness, the time for the kingdom of Christ is unlimited, it's endless. And this shows us the perspective in which we must see the entire history and also the future. Evil only gets limited time, but God's righteousness is forever. We even see that in the law of the Lord, the Ten Commandments. And we read that God visits the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation. But he shows his love and mercy to thousands of those who love him. There again, the difference between God's mercy and righteousness and evil. Evil only has limited time. God also shows here that the saints will reign with Christ. It is not a dragon who rules over the earth, but thrones are being set up. Jesus Christ rules together with his Christians. God created mankind in his image, and they were to have dominion over his world. Genesis 1, verse 28, 29. After mankind fell in sin, and evil came into this world, and Satan was given power by mankind, God restored mankind in its position. But now mankind, that are the believers. The unbelievers are being removed from it. And the believers are being restored as the mankind that was given a task to rule over this creation. The first Adam here is replaced by the second Adam. And he, Christ, as our head, will now reign, and we will reign with him for 1,000 years. That is what is being described here. I know there is quite some discussion and disagreement about these 1,000 years. There's a whole discussion among millennialists. There are pre-millennialists, post-millennialists, and amillennialists. I won't go into detail about it here. It will take way too much time. I could spend an entire Bible study on this one topic already, but I won't do that now. There is enough information available about that if you're interested in it. Here it is important to understand the meaning of these 1,000 years. Christ reigns with his Christians for 1,000 years. 1,000 years can be explained either as the entire time from the beginning to the end, the time after fallen sin to the time of the return, or as the time beginning with the ascension of Jesus Christ when Satan is defeated until the return of Jesus Christ. Personally, I believe it's the latter, from the ascension until the return, because here it speaks about Christ reigning with his saints, and we know that Christ obtained the victory over the dragon. In Luke 10, verse 18, Christ saw Satan falling down from heaven, and in Revelation 12, we see that Satan is hurled down from heaven, and that is the moment that he was defeated by Christ and was bound. So because of that, I believe that the 1,000 years here is the time from the ascension of Jesus Christ to his return. The time in which his word goes all over the earth, the time in which Christ sent out his disciples and his church, and he told them to him is given all authority in heaven and on earth. During these 1,000 years, the dragon himself cannot deceive the nations. In the Old Testament, we see how he could unite entire nations into big empires. According to Daniel 2, the time of the empires comes to an end after the Roman Empire, because then the kingdom of Christ is coming all over the world. The rock that came down from the mountain, not made loose with human hands. So the dragon himself cannot deceive the nations during that time. But we see that he still uses the beast and his prophet to do so. The power of Satan is not removed. He exercises his power now through the beast and his prophet. But the beast and his prophet are not able to do the same as the dragon can do. Their power is inferior to Satan's. They cannot unite together all the enemies against Christ and his people. At the end of the 1,000 years, when the 1,000 years expire, that is the time that Jesus Christ returns. God is preparing a stage for Christ's return. Part of his glory is the way in which he deals with Satan. For his glory to be made clearly visible for his entire world, Satan has to be released. Here again, it is just like God did with Pharaoh. Paul describes in Romans 9, verse 17, "For the scripture says to the Pharaoh, 'For this very purpose I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth.'" And it was a foreshadowing of the final defeat of the dragon, Satan. The final defeat is happening here, like Pharaoh called together all his hosts to pursue the Israelites. So here in his final attempt, Satan will muster the entire earth, all his allies, Gog and Magog, to attack the people of Christ. What the beast and his prophets could not do, Satan is going to do now. In Psalm 2, it's also prophesied, "The peoples of the earth and the kings come together in council and plot against the Lord and his anointed. But God, who sits in the heavens, laughs. He holds them in derision. They are as the sand of the sea." Satan and his armies in all their power are being shown here to make Christ's glory even greater. But then, again, here before the battle even started, they are destroyed by fire from heaven, just as happened with the beast in 19 verse 20, just as happened with Pharaoh and the Egyptians. God destroyed them before they were able to attack God's people. And also the dragon here is thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone, together with the beast and his prophet. Here again, this vision shows and encourages the church, the believers, that God is in control. And if this world becomes powerful, and if the dragon becomes powerful and is going to attack God's people, it is only for God and for Jesus Christ to destroy him, to show his almighty power and his glory. And then in the third vision, we see how the third enemy, death, is being destroyed. We don't have time for that now. I will deal with that. I will explain that in a sermon coming Sunday. For now, we will finish this Bible study. If you have questions, then you can email me your questions, or you can text them to me. I will answer them and in a separate document, and will distribute them before the next Bible study next month, and we'll post them online as well. Brothers and sisters, with that we come at the end of this Bible study. I hope you were blessed by this Bible study, and also that you will have a good discussion.